Identifying as a philosopher is weird because you never know how someone's going to react. For every person who finds it intriguing, there's one other who goes, "So are you analyzing me right now?" After awkwardly reminding them that that's psychology and not philosophy, the tension mounts and it can erupt in one simple question. "So do you just sit around and think all day?" Now, at times I've responded a bit defensively to this question, and I'll say, "Oh no, philosophers do a lot more than just think. They also read and write and teach. Some do research, others meet with clients as philosophical consultants." But I also have to wonder, why would it elicit such a defensive response? It's not that I feel like I have to prove that I can do philosophy and still live a rich, full life. I eat and dance and take pictures of my cat too, you know? Instead, I think the defensiveness is a response to the assumptions in that question. "So do you just sit around and think all day?" Because it's asked as if one wouldn't want to think all day, as if thinking isn't a valuable thing to do, but rather useless and practical and so uncool. Well, as you probably guessed, I'm here to defend thinking as very cool. Not only do I think thinking is one of the most important things we can do, but practically speaking, thinking can do some pretty important things for us too, like improve confidence, increase meaning, and be a truly transformative practice. In other words, we can think for a change. Good thinking is a process, not a product. And the thing about thinking is that even though it's basic and an activity that we should be able to do, not many of us know how to do it, at least not how to do it well. So we have to learn how to take the steps and make the moves and pursue those subsequent questions. In other words, thinking is a movement that doesn't necessarily end, which is why one can get lost in thought. But I understand why some people don't like thinking. I've been criticized before with comments like, "Oh, Corey, lighten up, you think too much." And my students have said, "Oh, my head hurts from all of this thinking." And you know, we live in a complicated world, so sometimes pursuing burning questions can get a little overwhelming. You can go from, "Oh, what's this?" to "Why did I find it?" to "What does it mean?" So thus, thinking can be a risky pursuit. If you think too much, people might judge you, you might break your brain, and end up in a cloud of anxiety, more confused and distressed than before. Unfortunately, if you sit down and start asking hard questions, I can't guarantee that this type of crisis won't happen for you. However, the good news is that this meltdown doesn't arise just from thinking itself. Well, I don't think that one can think too much. I do think one can think poorly, and that bad thinking is what can leave us feeling lost, distressed, and overwhelmed. The key then is to learn how to think well and to differentiate it from bad thinking. So let's go into metaphor mode. Imagine we're trying to understand the layout of an amusement park. Sometimes bad thinking can feel like you're getting a tour from a hyper apparition that pops up over there, flits by out of the corner of your eye, and then surprises you from behind. When you ask someone, "What do you think?" and they respond with a bunch of random proclamations from nowhere, it just doesn't make sense. It might even be a little scary, because there's not a path to follow. The tricky thing about bad thinking, though, is that sometimes it can seem like one idea does lead into another. One thinks if we have this, then we get that, which takes us there and brings us here. So there's movement and connection, which makes it seem coherent, but it can move so fast that it's kind of like seeing the amusement park from on a roller coaster. There can be hairpin turns, dizzying heights, stomach-wrenching loops, and you might end up saying, "I could hardly keep up, yet look where it's taken us. It must have been a good ride." But remember the metaphor. The goal wasn't to be exposed to as much of the park as possible in a breakneck flash or blur. We were supposed to understand the layout of the park. And to do that well, we have to go slowly, explore, see it from different perspectives and numerous angles. So now imagine that you're walking with a friend who wants to go through the park slowly. You're probably pulling them along saying, yeah, I see that building, but come on, we've got more ground to cover. Let's just go get on that roller coaster." And then they say, "But wait, what's behind the building and why is it there?" You see, by going slowly, your friend starts to consider new questions that otherwise might not have even occurred to you. And whatever is behind the building might simultaneously lend itself to more understanding and generate further questions. So before you know it, you're suddenly exploring above, around, and below this one corner of the park in a totally different way. Now, if you're impatient, you might get frustrated by your friend's questioning because they're not getting you where you wanted to go. So like an exhausted parent when their young philosopher child persistently asks, "Why? But why?" You might throw your hands up in the air and say, "I don't know, it doesn't matter, so stop asking." Or you could shut down the questioning and say, "Because it just is, there's your answer." An answer, an explanation. And that's another danger of bad thinking. It can leave us feeling too assured that we know certain things so well that we don't have to question anymore. But explanations kill exploration. So to see the difference between good and bad thinking, it's important to pay attention to that frustration. When we're in a hurry to get somewhere, to finish a task, or find an answer that we can wrap up and put in our pocket, thinking slowly and critically can be extremely uncomfortable. But that frustration can mean that we're doing something different and pushing beyond the usual. That discomfort can mean that we're really thinking, and it's in that moment when real discovery can happen. If you continue to push on, you might even start to experience thinking differently. In this way, learning to think well is pretty much like any other skill. It takes discipline and practice, and it can be really hard, especially at first. If I want to become a runner, I can't just go out and be a great runner right now. I have to first run a mile, which would be shamefully difficult. My lungs would be on fire, my form would be sloppy, my muscles would give out immediately. But with disciplined practice, I could soon run 2 miles, and then 5, and then 10, with way more grace and ease. As my lungs got stronger, my stride more efficient, and my muscles more toned, I could confidently say, I'm a good runner, and I might even genuinely enjoy going out for a run. So I know we went from exploring amusement parks to 10-mile runs, but I like this running analogy because I never said that the point of becoming a runner was to finish a marathon or cross state lines to get somewhere. The point was not to do, but to become a runner, to change myself, develop new skills, and expand my capacities. And learning to think well is much the same. If you can push your ability to think to new depths and new breadths, you might eventually write amazing books or enlighten audiences, but more important than the things that you can do are the ways that you can become. So this is what I mean by think for a change. Good thinking can alleviate the frustration and anxiety that arises from our deep want of watertight answers and explanations. We can learn from our amusement park friend that the slower we go with our thinking, the more we'll see that needs further consideration. And we'd be foolish to think that we'd ever reach the end of questioning, so we don't get solid answers. But we do get a way of moving through the world differently. By peeking around corners, spotting assumptions, identifying gaps in the things we think we already know, good thinking is an inherently creative practice that opens up new possibilities for how we can live. It allows us to see old aspects of our experiences that we might have taken for granted and understand ourselves and our relationships in radically new ways. So when I say think for a change, the point isn't to simply change what you think, but how you think. And I'm not suggesting that good things come from just changing your mind or that we can do away with the difficulties of life through positive thinking alone or seeing the world through rose-colored concepts. Instead, I'm talking about a kind of thinking that empowers us to navigate the highs and lows of our experiences with diligence, skill, humility, awareness, and fairness. I'm talking about a thinking that reflects a kind of freedom, a self-directed exploration, and a clarity that can be articulated and embraced as one's own voice. So you don't have to major in philosophy in order to cultivate the confidence and meaning that can arise from this disciplined practice of thinking well. But you do need to practice the moves, the steps, and the connections to ensure that you're walking through the park and not riding a roller coaster while breaking your neck. Most of all, thinking for a change involves being willing to ask genuine questions and courageously exploring them without needing to know where or when it will end and without even wanting it to.